الحمد لله نحمده ونشكره نستعين به جل وعلا نستهديه ونستغفره نعوذ به سبحانه وتعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا عباد الله أنصحكم ونفسي الآثمة بتقوى الله أحثكم وإياها على طاعته أحذركم وإياها وبال مخالفته جل وعلا ومعصيته أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده صدق وعده ونصر عبده وأعز جنده وهزم الأحزاب وحده سبحانه أول بلا ابتداء دائم بلا انتهاء لا يفنى ولا يبيد ولا يكون إلا ما يريد لا تبلغه الأوهام ولا تدركه الأفهام ولا يشبه الأنام حي لا يموت قيوم لا ينام وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وعظيمنا وحبيبنا وإمامنا وقدوتنا وأسوتنا وقرة أعيننا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وعبد الله ربه حتى أتاه اليقين رؤوف بالمؤمنين رحيم صلى الله عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله صلِّ اللهم عليه وعلى آله وأزواجه وأصحابه وأحبابه وأتباعه والتابعين وعنا معهم يا رب برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين أما بعد يقول مولانا عز وجل في المحكم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذ يمكر بك الذين كفروا ليثبتوك أو يقتلوك أو يخرجوك ويمكرون ويمكر الله والله خير الماكرين We're still with the ayahs that we've talked about last week indicating the hijrah. The ayah indicates the hijrah. وَإِذْ يَمْكُرُ بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا Allah Ta'ala is exposing the plots and the plans. We might remember we said المكر usually خَدِيعَ خَدِيعَ يعني means you do it in a cunning way. You do it in a dishonorable way. You don't fight your opponent face to face or fact to fact. You distort the facts. You make up lies and you do everything beyond evil, putting shaitan himself of the jinn to shame. For the human shayateen exceeds sometimes the jinn shayateen, as Allah indicates, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا لِكُلِّ نَبِيٍّ عَدُوًّا شَيَاطِينَ الْإِنسِ وَالْجِنِّ تقديم الإنس على الجن. يوحي بعضهم إلى بعض زخرف القول غرورا. زخرف is they beautify things that are lies. And غرورا, so that's what they do. Al-Quran Al-Karim says they just pass something they beautify which is a lie. An evil thing requires beautification. Well, the beautiful doesn't require beautification, does it? Why, something beautiful, you want to make it more? You can't, it's already beautiful, you can't make it more beautiful. No? وَلَقَدْ يَضُرُّ بِرَائِعٍ تَلْوِينُهُ The poet says that if you put colors on someone who's beautiful, you make it worse. Then you can leave it the way it is, it's much better. People don't realize these things. The beauty is already beauty. خير. فَذَي put زُخْرُف, they try to beautify the lie, like in Allah says, غُرُورَ غُرُورَ means they are fooled by Allah's patience on them. Similarly, when they do to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, we're talking about لأنه we are in times of hijrah, or what we remember the beginning of the new hijri year coming soon. to a theater near you. Alhamdulillah, due to the what do we call them, the bid'ah squad and the takfir squad we've had for the past 40 years, everybody five hadith from Mawlana Google, he calls everybody kafir or mubtadi' or mushrik, or everybody is other. He is the only one on the deen. Nobody else knows the deen. So now it's haram to actually celebrate the Hijri year. A'udhu billah, what they will go to grave extents to tell you how evil it is for your faith and how detrimental it is to the essence of your iman if you are happy because you remember the hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the mawlid of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or Nisf Sha'ban, or Isra wal Mi'raj, or these things that came actually with many meaningful things to Muslims. People did not, may have not studied the seerah in an academic way. In the old days, people were farmers. Many people were unlettered. I don't want to say illiterate, I want unlettered. They did not read and write. They were in their farms. Yani, you go back just 100 years ago, many people in Asia, Africa, predominantly Muslim majority societies were unlettered. How do you think they learned about their seerah and their deen and these things? You ask Maulana Muhyiddin Chishti of India, giving them couplets they sing while they're farming. And the people who actually tried to infuse the ilm of the seerah through bringing them together and reviving them, guiding them back to the deen. They did not do social activities for social activities, but they did social activities so they can guide people to Allah Azza wa Jal, ingrained in them. Because nowadays also the masajid are losing their roles in general. Instead of being houses that guide the khalq to al-khaliq, they turn the people to their creator, we turn the creation to the creation. Let's get together and celebrate. But a very nice celebration is very important. The social activities are very important. And once a masjid lose its direction and compass to take that creation and point him to Allah Azza wa Jal in a way that's suitable to Allah Azza wa Jal, then we have lost the whole mission. Everybody does social activities. We should as well. But Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa anna al-masajid lillah. The masjid, as Allah Ta'ala says, is for Allah. Make sure at least the end of the journey, it takes you to Allah. You see, you go to the way to Allah. You walk on the path to Allah. That your objective is Allah. يعني المقصد at the end is Allah. وَأَنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَا أَيَّتُهَا النَّفْسُ الْمُطْمَئِنَّةُ إِرْجِعِي إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ. These things. Al-Mustafa al-Akram, طبعاً we're talking about Al-Mustafa صلى الله عليه وسلم because it's the season of Hijrah. And I told you last week that the Hijrah was really في ربيع الأول. لكن and the Ummah sort of agreed to make the Hijrah the beginning of Muharram because of the niyyah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do Hijrah in Muharram. Or at the beginning, right after Eid. But today I think we really need to be not just creative in the sense of being innovative without institutionalizing the innovation as a practice of the deen, but being innovative to try to call the people to all kinds of events. Today our people don't know about the Hijrah because it's no longer permissible to celebrate the Hijrah because you got the bid'ah squad ready. When ask him, do you know the difference between istibra and istinja, wajibat versus sunan versus nawaqid? He doesn't. Lakin he tells you bid'ah and kafir and mushrik. Where do we go after this? Erasing, an institutional erasing of the memory of the Ummah. Start new. Oh, I have Salaf. I have people who, this ummah 1400 years ago came one after one after one after one. Today we need to bring back the talk about the hijrah in our homes. Unfortunately, because masajid sometimes won't allow us. But we have to bring them back to our home. We have to talk about the hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have to talk about the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because what I mean, what we have to talk, what does that mean? Because when we celebrate the Mawlid, we don't celebrate the birth of a human being. We celebrate the genesis of guidance and nur to the worlds. We celebrate the mission of the Prophets alayhi wa sallam, starting from Adam with the end of a Rasul Khatam sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. That's what we're celebrating here. We're not talking about being happy for someone's being born. Anyone. Today we need to talk about the hijrah. If you can't talk about it in the masajid, talk about it at home. Bring back the memories of hijrah, and this way, every time we talk about the hijrah, the memory comes back to your children and to your communities. Because the hijrah taught us lots of things and still teaches us lots of things, like we've talked continuation from last time. Among the most important lessons of hijrah is when Allah Azza wa Jal said, لا تحزن إذ يقول لصاحبه. Remember he said, إلا تنصروه فقد نصره الله إذ أخرجه الذين كفروا. The meaning of the ayah, if you don't grant, give him support and victory, Allah will give. Allah is not in need of your support or granting, giving the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم victory. Allah doesn't need that. But it's a test for you. He gave you health, wealth, power. Can you do something with it? Or are you going to use it for wrong things all the time? What are you going to do? It's a test. Does Allah need our support or our wealth? He's the one who gave us the health. He's the one who gave us the wealth. And He's the one who created us in the first place anyway. He doesn't need anything. Allahu al-ghani. Ya ayyuhan nasu antumul fuqara'u ila Allah. Wallahu al-ghaniyul hamid. You are really poor. You think you have, you are poor. If you think you have, you're miskeen, you're very poor. Wallahu huwa al-ghani. Allah is the one who's ghani. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore this life, no matter how long it is, it's this test. Lakin we as Muslims, we come back to Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Lano Sayyidina sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is this light that Allah Ta'ala sent for us so we can be guided. Like the poet said, عَشِقْنَاكُمْ وَلَا عَتْبٌ عَلَيْنَا فَكُلُّ الْحُسْنِ فِي تِلْكَ الصِّفَاتِ. We love you, Ya Rasulullah, and no one can blame us, for all the perfection and beauty are all gathered in you. It is not that we did it. He, Allah Ta'ala, is the one who gave him and made him and allowed him to guide us and lead us the way. Sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa azwajihi wa ashabihi wa sallam. Tasliman kathira. The first thing was la tahzan. Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was with him going out, as you know, in the hijrah. As-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, taban, even though he's Siddiq. Siddiq? Not just Sadiq. There is level of Sadiq, there is Saduq, there is Siddiq. As-Siddiq was with Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. He says, Ya Rasulullah, if someone looks down, where just looks, investigates these caves, he would see us. Just looks, he will see us. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Allah tells in the ayah, إِلَّا تَنْصُرُهُ فَقَدْ نَصَرَهُ اللَّهِ إِذْ أَخْرَجَهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Those who have covered the truth. Kufr is covering the truth. I know we always use it as disbelief. Sometimes it's important to go to the root of the word. Al-kufr means to cover the haqq. That's what kufr means. Those who cover the truth have forced him, worked so hard. Like Allah says in the ayah, وَإِذْ يَمْكُرُ بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Those who want to cover the truth, they are plotting and planning against you, Ya Rasulullah. Why? لِيُثْبِتُوكَ. They want to shackle you first. So you're shackled, this way they can humiliate you. أَوْ يَقْتُلُوكَ. If they can't shackle you, they want to kill you. If they can't shackle you, meaning silence you or kill you, أَوْ يُخْرِجُوكَ. Or they want to banish you. Make sure you're out of their territory. Because it's at the end territorial. In the dunya, well, nobody really owns anything in the dunya. Tell them they can be territorial all they want. Where is Fir'aun today? Where's Pharaoh, who owned 1/3 of the world?
Gone.
Well, the other Pharaohs will also go. No Pharaoh will stay.
In these aspects, when the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he leaves Mecca and he says, Wallahi innaki, or Wallahi anti, by Allah, you are one of the most beloved places for me. And had it not been that your people forced me to leave, I would have not left. And you imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leaving his home place, his birthplace. That's where he grew up. He doesn't know, as far as being raised, any other place other than this. That's where his father's tribe is, his mother's tribe is. That's where his fathers from Abdullah to Abdul Muttalib to Hashim to Abd Munaf to all the way to Ismail to Ibrahim. I mean, this is not some family that just happened to move to Mecca. This is a family that Sayyidina Ibrahim al-Khalil alayhi salatu wasalam planted in the valley of Mecca.
And now these people of Quraysh, who are supposed to be the custodian of the Kaaba. أَجَعَلْتُمْ سِقَايَةَ الْحَاجِّ وَعِمَارَةَ الْبَيْتِ كَمَنْ آمَنْ. Allah asks them, you are trying to make yourself being the custodian, and that you give water to the pilgrims, because Quraysh used to what? Be the custodian of the Kaaba of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, and they used to give the pilgrims water. Allah asks them for Quran saying, أَجَعَلْتُمْ سِقَايَةَ الْحَاجِّ. You made giving water to the pilgrims and being the custodian of the Kaaba, كَمَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ, equal to those who believe in Allah. Because they didn't want to believe in Allah, they forced the Rasul of Allah out. Not easy. Your mother, your father, لكن subhanAllah, شاءت حكمة الله. Allah's will is that his mother is, our mother Amina, is buried in the middle way between Mecca and Medina. They wanted him to be distanced from his family, right? The people of Quraysh. His mother is buried في الأبواء between Mecca and Medina. And his father, Abdullah, our father, Abdullah رضي الله عنه, is buried today, as we know today, in the prophetic masjid. He was buried in Medina at his relative's house, right? Bani Najjar. The place, the Bani Najjar, is a small masjid. With the expansion of the prophetic masjid, it is included within the prophetic masjid today. That's where the father of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. ويمكرون. They plot. ويمكر الله. And Allah has his own plans, his own ways. Yani plans means his own ways here. والله خير الماكرين. Allah is the one who exposes all the makr of everyone. The first thing, even when things are difficult, you're leaving your house, you're leaving your city, your companions are they're lost all their money. Not some of their money, all their money. Because the Sahaba radiallahu anhum who left Mecca, they couldn't take anything with them. They couldn't even sell their homes. They couldn't do anything. They just went with their clothing. They had to go light, and they had to go also hidden in a sense. They can't go all together. One after one goes, they meet up, they leave, etc., etc. They could not take anything. Can you imagine someone who leads a movement of reform and his companions who support him, and they're few, after 13 years, only like 100 people or less, they actually believe in him. Most of them are either the people who are weak, financially not strong, slaves, women. Most of them, few people were not, but most of them were like that. And now among them, they get killed, they get persecuted, they get tortured, they lose all their homes. Now they have to migrate, they lose their home, they leave their homes, but they lose all their wealth. Who would want to stay with someone? Would tell them, what's wrong with you, you're following him? Like nowadays, what's wrong with you? You're losing your homes, you're losing your positions, you're losing your wealth, you're losing, even you're being tortured. Just so we understand the iman of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, and why are they Sahaba? So we understand. We understand that iman is not really a word one says, But iman is actually a journey that one takes, an actual journey that one takes, where that iman becomes improved and better and better while you're being what? Facing challenges. You can only, why do you think they call the gold gold? Because they have to put the gold through what? Through fitna. What is fitna? Fitna means a lot of fire. They take the gold, which is mixed with other material, and they subject it to lots of heat. That heat separates the gold from stone, or the gold from other thing. The metal comes out very nicely when it's subject to heat. And if you're not subject to heat, you will never know the material of people. And that's why ulama Sira mentioned that Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, a man came to him and he says, I know someone, so and so, I know him. He tells Umar. Umar radiallahu anhu tells him, did you travel with him? Have you traveled with him? Safart ma'am? No, I didn't. You dealt with him business? No. قال اذهب فإنك لا تعرفه. Go, you don't know him. What do you mean you know him? Why did they call safar safar? Safar means travel, right? But safar, they call it so لأنه يسفر عن أخلاق الناس. Because difficulties exposes the reality of people. When do you know people? In times of ease? In times of ease, everybody is your friend. Huh? Like al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, Sayyidina al-Imam al-Shafi'i, Imam Ahl al-Sunnah, what he says in the poetry attributed to him, he says, وَفِي الزِّيَادَةِ إِذَا قَلَّ مَالِي فَمَا خِلٌّ يُصَاحِبُنِي وَفِي الزِّيَادَةِ كُلُّ النَّاسِ خِلَّانِي. He says, if I am in trouble, nobody wants to be my friend. When I have wealth and everything, everybody is my friend. حتى نحن, we understand الصحابة الكرام رضي الله عنهم. It wasn't simple. Iman to them was not, you know what, it sounds good. No. This is something they put their lives on رضي الله عنهم أجمعين. That's why they have our reverence and our respect and our dua and all these things. Because those people were not just people that thought, you know what, he sounds good. No. He is Muhammadun Rasulullah. Allah sent him. Difference. Difficulty in the situation, Allah Ta'ala tells us in the Quran, لا تحزن. Don't be sad. لا تحزن, don't be sad. And today people face all kinds of difficulties. Tara, I don't want to say our difficulties are comparable to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because it's not. No difficulties can be compared. I don't want to hear whining or anything. May Allah Ta'ala only reward us for our lack of actual efforts and our procrastination and our delays and our veils and our ignorance and our arrogance. Can you imagine before you were born, Allah takes away your father before you were even born? So in a tribal society, then shortly after you're born, Allah takes away your mother. Then your grandfather takes a hold of you and gets custody of you. Then Allah takes away your grandfather. Then Allah gives you an uncle, Abu Talib, who gives all his money to anybody who asks. You ask, he gives you all the money. So there's no money left for you. Then after that, when you marry and have children, Allah takes away your children one after the other. You bear your own children in your own hands. You tell me about it. Those of you who are fathers, you know what that means. Allah Ta'ala protect all our children. And not subject us to the Prophet's examples, because no one is worthy. And we have weak iman. May Allah help us. He buries Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. The authentic hadith says, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, while he is burying his own son, he says, إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ لَتَحْزَنْ إِنَّ الْعَيْنَ لَتَدْمَعْ وَالْقَلْبْ يَحْزَنْ الْقَلْبْ يَحْزَنْ وَالْعَيْنَ تَدْمَعْ وَلَا نَقُولُ مَا يُغْضِبُ الرَّبِّ. And the eye waters and weeps, and the heart is filled with sorrow, but I will not say anything that is displeasing to Allah. إِنَّا لِفِرَاقِكَ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ. O Ibrahim, for your departure, we are indeed لَمَحْزُونُونَ, filled with sorrow. But إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ.
Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The lessons from Hijrah, that's why I'm saying we need to revive learning. We will, inshallah, hopefully we will, because that's the right thing. This, hopefully that the Ummah will regain its strength, because today we have lots of challenges, and we would be strong against opportunistic infections and these things that happen when the immunity is low, that derail the Ummah from its path, that takes scissors and breaks, cuts the Ummah into segments and fragments, that takes light and burns the entire fabric of the Ummah to save the Ummah. Ajeeb. Now, since when you see ta'mir through tadmir? Since when do you see construction through destruction? Since when fire builds, but clay builds? La tahzan, don't be sad. Difficulties, yes, situations are difficult. You're leaving your city, you're forced out, you're losing all your wealth, your companions are this. Don't be judging things by what they always see. You never know. Allah may give you to deprive you, and may deprive you to give you. He may give you, didn't He give Fir'aun wealth? Didn't He power? Didn't He give Qarun wealth? But was that giving or depriving? إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَا يَطْغَى أَرْرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. Fir'aun became veiled by that which he thought he has. Qarun became veiled by that which he thought was giving. Because today we're always happy when Allah gives, and we oftentimes complain when Allah deprives. And that's because we don't understand Al-Haqq subhanahu wa ta'ala. He may give you to deprive you, and He may deprive you to give you. And if you really believe in Him, giving and depriving are the same, because they're both giving in reality. Al-ata wal-man' yatasawan. Now, what He gives is giving, and what He doesn't give is also giving. وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. He will give you. It's all giving. Even when, Ya Rasulullah, when you left Mecca and you said, it's most beloved to me, and the people forced me, and this, and you told Aisha radiallahu anha, أم المؤمنين, أصابني من قومك ما أصابني, I was, this has happened to me, etc., etc. Allah Ta'ala will give you. If you are with Allah, لا تحزن. Don't be sad. That's what the ayah says. La tahzan. Today we need to go back to this understanding. La tahzan. Don't be sad if you are with Him. When if you are not with Him, all the sorrow, you need to find Him. We all need to find Him in that way that's suitable to Him. The second thing that maybe we can move to understand the lessons from the Hijrah is, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is teaching us to move from victims to agency. From the mentality of victimhood. Oh, everybody is. The reason is Russia and America and Britain and India and Africa and Antarctica and Mars and Jupiter and the Sun and the Moon. To blame all you want. Blame all you want. Versus Al-Qur'an al-Kareem tells us that we have really no one to blame but us. Al-Qur'an wants us to go through the lessons from Al-Hijrah, to move from the mentality of victimhood to the mentality of agency. No situation is more difficult than what was happening to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca, where people were being killed not because they looked different. Same ethnicity, same thing. They just believed in La ilaha illallah. Though Hajj was not prescribed, Zakah was not prescribed, Salah was not mandated yet. Salah was mandated towards the end of the Meccan phase, in Isra wal Mi'raj. Was prayed, but was not mandated yet. Hatta the gathering, they were gathering for 6 years, 24, 30, 40 people. In Dar ibn Abil Arqam, etc., etc., few people. Even when they escaped, they were not allowed to escape. And imagine when they left Medina to Habasha, to Abyssinia, to Africa, they were not allowed. Okay, you don't want them, let them go. No. Quraysh dispatched after them someone all the way to the king of Abyssinia so that he can actually take them back hostages and kill them. Even leaving with your faith, you're not allowed to leave. It reminds me with what happened to the Muslims in Sicily. To Sicily, in today Italy, Sicilia, yani. Most people know about it from the movie Godfather. No, it's not the movie we're talking about. There was a real event. Muslims were there 300 years in Sicily. And in the capital only, Palermo, in Sicily, there was more than 300 masajid. When the Normandians or the Normans came, they said, according to them, that the majority of the population in Sicily were Muslims, and they had what they had to do is they had to treat them like Andalus next door, like southern Spain today. You know, you have rights, and that's why after even the collapse of the Muslim ruling, for example, in Sicilia or in Sicilia or in Sicily, they actually were ministers, they were involved in government, they were writers, they were this, they were this. They were the majority of the people. Ibn Jubayr al-Andalusi, one of the historians, يعني just الشيء بالشيء يذكر. Ibn Jubayr says, he documents, he was a historian who, in the old days, historians used to travel to the site. And not like today, our reporters told us that this is what happened. You know how the news today is more views than news. Huh? It's views. But they like to say news, they don't like to say views. Huh? Okay, khair, inshallah. Well, everybody has his own views and everybody wants to make his views news. In the old days, historians would travel to the place. That was maybe in today's language, embedded reporter. He's in the field. Huh? Ibn Jubayr was one of them. They used to go and they would write what they see. And he was writing. He says one of the things that he came after the Muslim rule collapsed in Sicily. The majority were Muslims. Obviously, eventually they were entirely killed. They had ran to the mountains there in Sicily. And until today, if you see, you go see some of their graves there or so. And eventually they were all killed and left. You could not stay if you don't conform. And obviously, many historians say many were forced to change their faith by the sword, obviously. Funny enough, how ironic that what Muslims are accused with is usually not necessarily Muslims, to be honest with you. And that's not necessarily right, regardless who does it, it's wrong. But Ibn Jubayr says, he says, among the things that made me feel crying, I don't remember his exact word, yani emotional or crying or so. He says, as we are boarding the ship to leave Sicily, as he's coming as a foreign national from Spain, from Andalus, historian, he says, I see an old man coming to me with his barely teenage daughter. He says, he tells the Muslims that are leaving because they were Hujjaj. They're going from there on the way to Hajj. So the ships go on the way to Hajj from Spain, for example, today to Sicily, etc., all the way. He says, someone came and said, Ibn Jubayr says, here's my barely teenage daughter. I am scared about what would happen to her. Take her with you, I trust you, and find her, be as a parent for her, and find her a suitable Muslim, mu'min, believing husband. Take her, go. Because I am not sure if we're going to be safe tomorrow night here. This is just about 900 years ago, or less actually. النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم, what he wanted to show us is is he wanted to show us that this there's a need to move from victim to agency, from this mentality of victimhood, of blaming everyone for everything, to actually doing something. And that's where you see that in the ulama of the seerah statement, when they said that when Quraysh came to them, all of them, they came, they said, Ya Rasulullah, they didn't say Rasulullah, they said, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa ashabi wa azwaji wa sallam, if you need to be the leader, a king, we will make you a king. Though Quraysh is a tribe, we will make you a king. We will turn it into kingdom and you become the king, no problem. If you want money, tell us how much money you want. Basically, here's an open check. Write your number. We will collect it from each other. You will have the most money amongst us. Because if you have the most money, then you can do things, right? And we'll give you the most money. If you want to marry someone, tell us, we will give you whatever. And he told them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, allegedly in the what the ulama of the seerah say, Ya am, law annahum wada'u al-shamsa fi yamini wal-qamara fi yasari, or whatever he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to that effect, if they put the sun in my right hand and the moon in my left hand, so that I leave this mission, I would never do until I spend my whole life and die as such. To tell you, victimhood was not an option, but actually agency. They can give me whatever they want. They can afflict whatever they want. That will never take me away from actually going to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and actually move in the right direction, even if I have the moon and the sun. Because my da'wah is not da'wah about possession. Who possesses the moon? Who possesses the sun? Or who possesses earth? Only the Creator has possession of all these things. All I want to do is reform, guide people to be better people. Try to make this world a better place, so that people are more decent. Even if they disagree, you know what? Even if they don't believe in Allah, let them believe in akhlaq. Let them have akhlaq. Because I can't force them to be believers. إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرٍ لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِمُسَيْطِرٍ. But what I can at least do, what they can benefit from me, is الرَّحْمَ الْعَامَّةِ. Allah made me a rahmah, and that rahmah is through akhlaq. It brings them to the akhlaq. It elevates them through ethics and through refinement of the human being. So the human being becomes a better human being. The fabric of the human being that has potential to be the best reaches its maximum potential. That's the first lesson that we learn from the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam here, in the issue of turning victimhood to agency. No victimhood business here. Allah gave you, what are you doing about it? Oh, you're watching? You're a spectator in the field of da'wah? Well, إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادِ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا. Your hearing, the Quran says, which means your hearing, your sight, your faculties, your wealth, your health, you're going to be asked. The second thing also that's very important here is, it's not that in this line of da'wah, Ya Rasulullah, that he taught us in the hijrah, then the hijrah signifies that you could have become a king in Mecca. You could have become the most wealthiest in Mecca. You could have been the whatever you wanted in Mecca. All you have to do is make a deal with these guys, you know. You make a deal with them, then they become something, they give you a little bit more. What the Prophet ﷺ wanted to teach us is something that's very important. The hijrah was not just about forfeiting which is nice to be a king, nice to have a lot of wealth. But the hijrah was also about adding much more responsibility. إِنَّا سَنُلْقِي عَلَيْكَ قَوْلًا ثَقِيلًا. We shall account you with a heavy, ثقيل responsibility. You're not just forfeiting all these things, but you're actually taking lots of responsibility. And that's why the mission of the Prophet ﷺ, what the hijrah reminds us with, because we all are in the atmospheres of hijrah, is that it's not just sometimes forfeiting, because today people, they migrate, they do hijrah for wherever there's comfort. He says, I got a job in Texas, I'm moving to Texas, Sheikh. Alhamdulillah, Allah bless you. What? He says, it's more pay, more comfort, mashallah, very nice. Do hijrah. Ya Allah, bismillah.
He does hijrah. People do hijrah for what makes for their dunya today. Hijrah from dunya to dunya. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned us to change the direction. Do hijrah from the dunya to Allah. From the makhluq to al-khaliq. ترى هجرة from dunya to dunya كالحمار يعني يدور في الرحى. Like Ibn Atta says, he says, the one who does hijra from creation to creation is like the old donkey. You know how they used to grind wheat in the old days? They put one stone and then they put the wheat and then they put a stone on it and they connect the stone to a donkey going around in circles. They only make the rope so big that he goes around in circles. So the donkey keeps going in circles. This is the old way of grinding, right? Circles, circles, until what? The wheat now is crushed. Ibn Atta says, he says, the one who's doing hijrah from dunya to dunya is like that donkey. He's just going in circles making the same, we know that, okay. فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. That's why in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, first hadith for Sahih al-Bukhari, whoever is hijrah is, فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا. Whoever is hijrah is for a dunya, that's what he's gonna get. He'll get the dunya. Okay, enjoy. What do you live? 20 more years? 30 more years? 50 more years? Take. فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِدُنْيَا وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And whose migration is for Allah. Who's al-baqi? Al-dunya baqiya? Am Allah is al-baqi? والدنيا فانية كل من عليها فان ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام. True, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forfeited kingdom and forfeited wealth and forfeited the position in society and forfeited forging an alliance with some of these guys who were doing lots of evil things, and he lost the money and he lost some of his companions and he lost his parents and he lost his grandparents and he lost his children even and he lost his home and all this. لكن what he gained is ويبقى وجه ربك. The one that remains for you is Allah. وَاللَّهُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. Allah tells him, Ya Rasulullah, Allah is خَيْر وَأَبْقَى. Allah is better and more everlasting. From the messages of hijrah that we can learn. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه يغفر لكم. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إرغاما لمن جحد به وكفر. أشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا وحبيبنا وطبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. ما اتصلت عين بنظر وسمعت أذن بخبر. عباد الله اتقوا الله العظيم حق تقواه، راقبوه مراقبة من يعلم ويعتقد بأنه يرى. يعني عباد الله, observe Allah as if you are seeing Him, though you don't see Him, but He certainly sees you. اعلموا أنه لا يضر وينفع. Realize and be certain that no one can harm or benefit. No one can connect you or disconnect you. No one can give you or deprive you. No one can help you or harm you except by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. واعلموا أن الله تعالى أمركم بأمر بدأ فيه بنفسه وثنى بملائكة قدسه قال تعالى ولم يزل قائلا عليما إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين. أعلي يا مولانا كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم من أراد بالإسلام والمسلمين خيرا فوفقه إليه, من أراد بهم غير ذلك فهده يا ربنا سواء السبيل أو اكشف عنا مكره وشره.
اللهم آت أنفسنا تقواها، زكها أنت خير من زكاها، أنت وليها ومولاها، اشف اللهم مرضانا، عاف مبتلانا، فك أسرانا، ارحم موتانا. يا الله، everyone who came to this blessed house of yours, in this blessed hour of yours, in this blessed place of yours, in this blessed day of yours, forgive all our sins, يا رب العالمين. يا الله، guide us to be better, and يا الله، guide us to love you and love your Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and embrace the meanings of the Risala. Allahumma ya Allah, all of us, or any of us, and everyone in the entire Ummah, ya Allah, anyone who has any issues, any difficulties, any diseases, any illnesses, ya Allah, grant them from the, turn them from the dis-ease to ease, ya Rabbal Alameen, from difficulty to ease, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, there are many people who have conditions, health conditions, grant them shifa, ya Allah. Ya Allah, our parents, our grandparents, and our great-grandparents, give them Jannatul Firdaus, ya Allah, with the company of your prophets, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, keep Iman and the Nur of Islam in the light of and the light of Islam in the hearts of our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren until we all, ya Rabbal Alameen, are assembled before you, ya Rabbal Alameen. Allahumma ya Allah, this Ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, granted your blessing, ya Rabbal Alameen. Granted peace, ya Rabbal Alameen. Give it, ya Allah, rahmah, ya Rabbal Alameen. A special and extra that you give your awliya, ya Allah, and your special awliya, ya Allah. Ya Allah, make the difficulties disappear and turn the nufus and the hearts of people into the best of hearts, and the minds of people into the best of minds, and the actions of people into the best of actions, and the words of people into the best of words, ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, free those who are held hostage, and ya Allah, free those who are oppressed, and grant them, ya Rabbal Alameen, ease, justice, and victory, ya Allah. And ya Allah, guide and then bless everyone on earth, ya Rabbal Alameen, every single one, whoever they are, ya Rabbal Alameen. Allahumma ighfir lil muslimina wal muslimat wal mu'minina wal mu'minat al ahya' minhum wal amwat, innaka ya rabbana sami'un qareebun mujibun lid da'awat. واخر دعوانا ان الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد واله.